my treasures found. So when I die, gonna open my eyes with a different kind of crown. Hey!
See you. good morning to you guys. Welcome. Glad that you're here. You guys joining us online. It's good to see you. Hopefully you're there. Are you guys ready to get started? All right, we stand. My soul.
I don't know how to explain it, but I know the words will hardly do. Miracles and signs and wonders aren't enough for me to prove to you. Don't you know I've always loved you? Even before there was time, though you turn away, I tell you still. No, I've always loved you, and I always will. Greater love has not a man than the one who gives his life to prove. That he would do anything, and that's what I'm gonna do for you. Don't you know I've always loved you? Even before there was time, though you turn away, I tell you still.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much just being able to come before you and worship. And Father, I pray that you had our hearts in worship, Lord. And I pray now that we would just tune into your word. Father, help us to hear from you today, God. And God, we're hungry for your word. And Lord, if we're not, make us desperately needy for it now, Father, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
so good to be with you guys. Would you open your Bibles, please, to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. We are going to look at verses 32 to 34 today. Matthew 9 and verses 32 to 34. As you know, we are working through a series in the Gospel of Matthew called The Kingdom. Somebody say The Kingdom. Matthew's focus is the kingdom, and that's why we've entitled the whole series that. It's the kingdom of God that is ushered in because the Lord Jesus comes and he announces, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And that's Matthew's focus from the beginning of the gospel to the end of the gospel. The focus is the kingdom of God. Now, in the last couple of chapters, we've seen that Jesus is doing these authenticating signs, and we've named them authenticating signs because they are signs and wonders, miracles, healings, and the like that point to the fact that he is the one unique Son of God. They're designed to be enough revelation from Jesus to cause people to listen to what he says, because this one thing never changes, and that is that faith, saving faith, comes by hearing. That never changes. That's the way God has designed it. Saving faith comes by hearing. So Jesus does these miracles, signs, and wonders that will not save anyone. However, they are signs that he is the one unique Son of God, and as he does them, then some people begin to listen and are saved by the preaching. Not all of those authenticating signs had the same reviews when they were seen. Some people received, some people did not, and our text today is a case in point. If you look there at verse 32, Matthew chapter 9, follow along with me, somebody say, I will. As they were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to him. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke, and the crowds marveled, saying, never was anything like this seen in Israel. But the Pharisees said, he casts out demons by the prince of demons. Now we'll just stop right there for today. And again, I'll make mention that there are a couple of parallels. One parallel is at Luke 11, the other is at Mark 3, and it's kind of a parallel of sorts. It's not exactly the same, but it does give us some insights. Crowds, I would mention right up front, crowds in the text of Scripture. You notice in our Scripture we have the crowds marveling. Amen? Crowds in the text of Scripture always represent the world. That's consistent throughout the Gospels, that the crowds represent the world. Matthew's focus, you remember, is the kingdom of God. And in order to highlight the kingdom of God, he has to highlight the other kingdom as well. So as Jesus has come into the world as the light of the world and bringing the kingdom with him, the kingdom of God, the other kingdom has to be highlighted as well, so that we understand that there's an extreme division between these two kingdoms. And it's not even possible for a person to have a foot in one and a foot in the other. They're either in one kingdom or they're in the other. That's the only way it is. So Matthew focuses on that. And it's interesting, isn't it, that when Jesus begins to talk about the kingdom of God, that he says that, you know what, it's difficult to see the kingdom of God. And that's always the way Jesus talks about the kingdom of God. It's entirely misunderstood. You can't see it. Everybody's looking for something physical, but the kingdom of God is not that. Now, he does the same thing with the other kingdom. It's exactly the same way. It's not so easy to see the other kingdom. Neither one of the kingdoms, the kingdom of God or the kingdom of the world, are easy to see. Here's what I mean. When you think about the kingdom of the world, it's the kingdom of darkness is the way that the Bible describes it. And you would think that would be pretty easy to see. It would be, you know, occult practices and witchcraft, and it would be chasing these crazy things. But sure, that's part of it, but that's not generally the way the kingdom of the world operates. Generally, it's right out in the open. It's right out in the open, and practically everyone is in that kingdom. So it's difficult to recognize it as a kingdom. Now, in our text this morning, Matthew brings the kingdom of darkness into view for us. And he does that by highlighting three negative responses to Jesus. These are responses, I'll clue you in here, these are responses that keep people in the kingdom of darkness. These responses chain people to the kingdom of darkness. Even though, watch now, even though they're hearing the gospel of the kingdom of God, these responses are the responses that keep people in the kingdom of darkness. So note now, three negative responses to Jesus. And I can't go anywhere. Three negative responses to Jesus. You'll have to believe me. Have faith, right? Somebody say, have faith. Three negative responses to Jesus. Number one, I'm going as slow as I can, guys. Some people, I appreciate those guys a lot, but I'm going to kick them later. Some people are brought kicking and screaming to Jesus. So three negative responses to Jesus. Number one, some people are brought kicking and screaming to Jesus. Look there at verse 32, if you would, please. Verse 32, as they were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to him. You know already probably what needs to be highlighted there, don't you? Was brought to him. In the previous encounter, if you look in your text of Scripture, you're in chapter 9 there, and just the previous encounter back at verse 27, do you see that? Verse 27, you remember two blind men found their way to Jesus because they had already had some revelation of who Jesus is. Remember that? The Son of David. They had some revelation that this was the Messiah, and they had enough revelation that they were coming to see Jesus. But this is entirely different. This man is physically capable of coming to Jesus, of finding his way anyway, and he does not come, but instead is brought. Are you with me? Now, the reason that he's brought, the reason that he doesn't come on his own, is given, and that's demonic oppression. This man did not have his own mind. It's a mind that's oppressed. The Greek word there for oppressed means under the control of a demon. Controlled by the passions, we know from Ephesians chapter 2, to be under the control of a demon means to be simply in the control of your own passions and your own desires, the passions of your flesh and the desires of your mind, Ephesians 2. So there's no affection or desire for Jesus, but rather an affection and a desire for this world and what I want. The Bible says the God of this world, don't forget this, this is always the thing we need to look at. The Bible says that the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers so they cannot see the gospel of the glory of Christ. That's his aim. Let me oppress these people enough. Let me possess them enough. Let me get them so interested in the world that they cannot see the gospel of the glory of Christ. Let me enslave them in their own passions. This man had to be brought to Jesus. Reminds me of a man who disrupted church all the time. I was just telling somebody, this North Park Church has been 15 years of battles for me. I don't know how long I can do this, but there was a man who was constantly, and some of you are going to remember this, but he was constantly messing, just disrupting the church service. And the way that he would do it would be he brought his whole family, and he would just always mess with his kids. Now, listen to me. I'm telling you, the kids were not the ones messing. He was. He was always messing with his kids. He was goofing around with them, and he was... It was ridiculous, and so I met with the man. I said, what are you doing? Why are you doing that in church like that? Why are you acting that way? And he said, well, I don't really want to be there. I'm coming for my wife. I said, well, if you're coming for your wife, maybe think about straightening up and acting like you want to be there. And he said, this is what he said, quote, well, I'm not going to make it easy for her. He was, listen to me now, he was a force for Satan, keeping his family from knowing Jesus. Anybody hearing me? A stumbling block, the Bible says, in the road, in their road to come to Christ. That's what he was, a force for Satan, not for God. Now, he's a person who had to be dragged kicking and screaming to church. He had to be brought. Didn't mean he wanted to be there, didn't mean he was going to come to Christ, he just had to be brought. Now it's interesting in the text, that's not the first time that we've seen those words, had to be brought to Jesus. The last person who's described as being brought to Jesus, yeah, I just did air quotes, sorry, but the last person we saw is found back at the beginning of chapter 9, who was so-called brought to Jesus, same words. And you'll recall that this guy, though, was paralyzed. He's unable physically to come to Jesus. And the striking contrast is this. He wanted to come to Jesus. And when he did come to Jesus, when he was brought to Jesus, he was brought on a bed. You know, it seems like four guys had to bring him in on a bed. And Jesus comments on the guy's faith. He says, yeah, he's saved. He's a son. He calls him a son. He wanted to be brought to Jesus. He could not physically get there, but he wanted to be brought to Jesus. Are you hearing me? Now, on the other hand, this man is demon-possessed in our text, demon-oppressed in our text, and he's essentially dragged in, so there's a big difference here. This is confirmed if you look at our text again at verse 33. And when the demon had been cast out. See, even that speaks of force, doesn't it? Force. Naturally, the demon did not want to come out of the man. He didn't want that at all. A demon's greatest desire is possession. It's to be in someone and control someone. That's what ownership... Do you understand that possession is the nature of the two kingdoms? Possession is the nature of the two kingdoms. So a demon is always looking to own somebody, always looking to control somebody. This is the type of possession that demons work for, keeping people blind to their need for Jesus, keeping people unwilling to come to Jesus, keeping people so tied up in some identity that they think they need to have, or some desire for approval, or something in the world, something where they're following the passions and desires so that they have really no need for Christ. Oppressed. Now, here's what's amazing. People in this condition are so oppressed and harassed in mind and in body that you know, things begin to get physical. They begin to fall apart. Now, we all fall apart, but we fall apart in different ways. This is self-destruction fall apart. And yet, in the midst of this, watch this, I mean, their life is crumbling, their body's crumbling, their mind is crumbling, and yet, let me just find any way that I can to stay away from Jesus. I mean, I want freedom, I want out of this, but, you know, not that way. Anything but that. So, he's dragged to Jesus. some people are brought kicking and screaming to Jesus. But there's another more subtle, watch this, another more subtle negative response to Jesus in the text. Number two, some people love only what Jesus can do. Some people love only what Jesus can do. Look at verse 32 with me again. I'm going to go back over this verse because I want to couple it with verse 33. Verse 32, as they were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to him. And then verse 33 really goes with this idea. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke, and the crowds marveled, saying, never was anything like this seen in Israel. So the crowds marveled, and I want you to notice in the text, they marveled, but there's no mention of faith, as we've seen so often. There's no mention of faith or of following him as those things that were praised in previous texts. Faith and following him, right? We saw that over and over again in the past. Yes? Somebody say yes. The crowds merely marvel at what Jesus can do. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things in the text that the world loves about Jesus. A couple of things that the world loves about Jesus. I think this will be helpful to you. Number one, the world loves the capacity of Jesus. The world loves the capacity of Jesus. That's one of my favorite words. I pray for capacity all the time. But notice in the text, at verse 32, as they were going away. Do you see those words? Kind of overlooked words a little bit. As they were going away. Who's they? Jesus wasn't going anywhere. His disciples weren't going anywhere. As they were going away. Well, it refers back to verse 31. Look back at verse 31 and remember these two blind men got healed, and what did they do? They went away and they started to spread his. That's what it says at verse 31. And so verse 32 picks up and says what? As they were going away, as these two blind men were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man and a mute was brought to him. See it? The point is this. No sooner had the blind men gone than a demon-oppressed man is brought. People love the capacity of Jesus. I mean, in some ways they love his omnipresence, in other ways they hate it, but the fact that he's everywhere all the time, you know, the fact that I can talk to him anytime I want, I was sharing the gospel with a man in the hospital a few months ago, and he was not the patient, he was a visitor, but I was sharing the gospel with him, and he was talking about his horrible lifestyle. I mean, it was horrible lifestyle. Addicted to all sorts of things that you can think of. And I said to him, I just finally interrupted, and I said, you need Jesus. You need Jesus. And you know what he said to me? He said, oh, yeah, I talk to him all the time. Oh, yeah, I talk to him all the time. The world loves the capacity of Jesus. but I want you to understand something this morning. That is a purely imaginary Jesus. Imaginary. Do you hear what I'm saying? That is an imaginary Jesus. Now, what Jesus said about himself is, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Do you understand that Jesus is a no-show? He's imaginary when he's just the guy that I want to talk to because I want to believe he's what I want him to be. The world loves his capacity. They're like a married man who goes to his secretary for an occasional fling. All of the commitment is elsewhere. They only go to Jesus when they feel the need. Anybody home? They love the capacity of Jesus. Secondly, the world loves the capability of Jesus. You knew we were going here, didn't you? The capability of Jesus. Verse 33. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke. That's when the people marveled. So, as we established earlier, the demon does not want to comply, but is forced in the face of the supremacy of Christ. The demon has to answer to Jesus. People love the capability of Jesus. The Bible says that Christ is as much superior to angels and demons as his name is to superior to any other name. He's the Son of God. They're his creatures. They answer to him. The result of casting out the demon is that the mute man spoke. Now, I want to make a note real quick. Not every mute person that Jesus heals is in that condition because they have a demon. This is specified. And then the opposite is also true. Not every demon oppression or possession results in making a person mute. Sometimes they talk too much, right? Be quiet, he says, sometimes. Jesus healed purely physical issues. He healed demonic mental issues. If you look back at chapter 8 for just a minute, I think this pretty well covers it. If you look at chapter 8 and verse 16, notice there that evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. So he does the whole gamut, doesn't he? Jesus does it all. And the point is this: Jesus, the great physician, knows exactly what needs to happen. He knows what's needed. He knew all people, John 2:24. He knew what was going on. He's alert. He knows how to take care of things. When the mute man was brought to him, you notice that there's no diagnosis. There's no mystery. He knows exactly what to do. Jesus doesn't have to check him out. He knows precisely what needs to happen. So the world loves the capacity and they love the capability of Jesus. In the world's heart and mind, that's an imaginary Jesus. Now, he's got all that, but not for them. Verse 33, again, back to our text, chapter 9 and verse 33. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke, and the crowds marveled, saying, "Never was anything like this seen in Israel." That word marveled there is to look with wonder. So they looked on Jesus with wonder, and they were even saying things like, "Never was anything like this seen in Israel." So they loved what they were seeing. They looked on it with wonder. This is great entertainment. This is fantastic. I think I'll follow this guy around. I want to see more of this. I just want to make a note real quick. If I had a soapbox, I'd get on it right now. I just want to make a note real quick. Do you recognize this, church, North Park Church? Listen, you who are getting fed the right way, listen to me a minute. Do you realize that the preaching in most Christian churches today is so man-centered that the only thing that anybody's getting out of it is that Jesus is all about what I can get? They make the gospel and they make the Old Testament stories into such man-centered instead of Christ-centered nonsense that the people are trained to see Jesus, God, as something that they need to get in order to have a better life. They're only interested in what Jesus can do. They're being trained that way. Do you know that that's why you have the battle when you go out there and try to share the gospel? Because that's what you're running into. A false Jesus just does what I want him to do. Well, the crowd saw the signs and acknowledged that there was no one who ever did anything like Jesus did. But let me point something out to you. The crowd always turned back. Read the Gospels. What did the crowd always do? One thing was consistent. They always turned back. Always. In fact, this crowd is much the same crowd that later on would cry out, "Crucify him." That was the crowd too, wasn't it? What happens to people who only love Jesus for what he can do? What's going on with those people? Turn over to Matthew 13 for a minute. What happens to people who only love Jesus for what he can do? Look at Matthew 13 and verse 18. Got it? All right. Here then, Jesus says, hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while, and when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. Verse 22, as for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. So there are a whole lot of people who love what Jesus can do, but that's only the only part of Jesus they love. So what exactly is wrong here? What's wrong is this. There's no relationship. No relationship. See, these people never really knew Jesus. They were snatched away, fell away, or proved unfruitful. All three unsaved. Now that's weird because you look at it and you say, well, they received the word. But any word that's received and then is unfruitful afterward is an unsaved word. It's unsaved. You will be fruitful if you're saved. You will be. They were not born again. There was no change in affections. Does anybody here know that when you're actually born again, you can't get away from God? You can't. You can't get away from his word. You can't get away from him. There's nowhere you can go. They still love the world, not Jesus. And Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. That's a deal. You just keep going. Now, there's nothing at all wrong. Listen to me carefully. There's nothing at all wrong with coming to Jesus because you're afraid of death. Nothing at all wrong with coming to Jesus because you get a wake-up call suddenly, something happens, you know, some difficulty, some family issue, something. Nothing wrong with that, but listen to me. You must not stay there. You must be growing in affection for Jesus so that it drives you to know him. To know him. The world loves the capacity and the capability of Jesus, but they, you know what? They sure don't love the cost. They don't love the cost. And by the way, that's number three. Some people are brought kicking and screaming to Jesus. Some people love only what Jesus can do. And some people hate the cost of following Jesus. This is represented back at chapter 9 in our text in verse 34. Chapter 9 and verse 34. But the Pharisees said, he casts out demons by the prince of demons. The reaction to Jesus, think about this now, you see that. The Pharisees said he casts out demons by the prince of demons. Think with me a moment. Somebody say, I'll think. The reaction to Jesus is sometimes so violent that people will call what is absolutely good and perfect, they will call it evil in order to protect themselves from any change or to protect themselves or protect the sin they love. Let me give you just a little bit of background to our text. It's sort of late in the day to get background, isn't it? But it fits here better. So I want to show you what's going on in the text. This is so key. Jesus is still at Capernaum. Do you remember that that's where Jesus lives now? So he's in northern Galilee, in Capernaum, on the north end of the Sea of Galilee. That's a big lake. There's a lot of space between there and Jerusalem. So what in the world are the Pharisees doing in Capernaum? That's weird. But Mark chapter 3 and verse 22 tells us. Are you ready for this? The scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons he casts out demons. So the Pharisees came from Jerusalem, 78 miles south. They didn't drive their Cadillac there. They came from Jerusalem, 78 miles, and now the crowds have been following Jesus for some time. They've come from all over that region, we read. And for some time now, the reports of Jesus have been circulating. We also read that at least twice now. Now these reports have come to the capital city and to the temple and to the scribes and to the Pharisees. And they are coming to see him to see if the reports are true. What we need to understand is one of the primary responsibilities of the scribes, the religious leaders, was verification of the prophet to see if somebody was real, if they were authentic. That was their job. Somebody might even be the Messiah because everybody's looking for the Messiah at this time. Just like you and I are looking for the return of Christ, they were looking for him to show up the first time. So when the reports were made of authenticating signs, miracles, wonders, it was their job to go and investigate the man and either validate him or call him out. By the way, that's why they went to see John the Baptist. Do you remember that encounter back in chapter 3? They went to see John the Baptist. They sent men, the Bible actually says they sent men from Jerusalem to see who he was, and they questioned him. Are you Elijah? Are you the prophet? Who are you? So they go to see Jesus. And when they see that all that has been reported is true, they also, watch this now, don't miss this, they also see the crowds. And their envy kicks into overdrive. And all reason is thrown out because envy takes over. Envy. Listen, do you know that at the end of Jesus' ministry, even Roman governor Pilate knew, the Bible says, knew that it was out of envy that the religious leaders had turned Jesus over to him. Their envy was obvious. And look, you know, where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there's going to be what? Disorder and every evil practice, the Bible says. And can you imagine, listen for a minute, can you imagine The scribes and the Pharisees, they travel all that way. They're absolutely certain that what they're going to see is false authenticating signs and wonders. This isn't going to be true. It's not going to be what people are saying it is. They travel all that way to see it. How many times have we seen a con, a shyster, you know, a scam? How many times have we had to do this? So they go and look. It's all real. It was authentic when they got there. And, you know, they could not deny that what they were seeing was clearly signs that had never been seen in Israel before. Never. But they could ill afford the cost of admitting that Jesus is authentic. We can't do that. Do you know that the cost of following Jesus always sorts out the religious from the righteous? Always. Always sorts out the frauds from the faithful. Always sorts out the stillborn from the born again. Always. The cost. So when the authenticating signs are verified, the scribes and Pharisees respond in the most vile way that you could possibly imagine. He's possessed by the devil. He casts out demons by the devil. The claim is this: the only way it's possible for Jesus to be casting out demons is because he's possessed with the leader of the demons. He's got Satan in him. That's why he can tell demons what to do. See this now. See this now. Religious people are often the most violently opposed to the real Jesus. That's a fact. Why is that? Well, because they love their tradition, they love their life, they love their comfort, they love the approval of man. So people love to be religious. Beware of adopting a religion. Now, I'm going to ask so much of you this morning, because I'm going to ask you to dig deep into where you're at. Beware of adopting a religion so that its rules dictate what you believe, what you do and what you don't do, instead of the Word of God. Let me give you two verses, and I'm going to read these instead of sending you there, but I want you to think with me about these two verses. First of all, this is Matthew 15, verse 6. Jesus said of the Pharisees, "For the sake of your tradition, you have made void the Word of God." Now couple that with John 8:31, where Jesus says, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." In one case, he says, you're so religious that all you do is pay attention to tradition, and that's what you're believing, what somebody told you. And in the other case, he says, yeah, but, you know, you're doing that, but if you were actually my disciple, you'd pay attention to the Word of God, and what would happen as a result of you paying attention to the Word of God is what? You'd find freedom. You'd be free. You'd really get saved. By the way, now I need to tell you that religion takes many forms. You're wondering, you know, man, Lynn is railing on this today, and none of us are Catholics. But look, religion takes a lot of forms. Do you know that? There's a whole lot of very religious Baptists, or, you know, religious evangelicals, whatever that is anymore. religion takes all sorts of forms, and there's a lot of unchurched religious people. They're in some organization that's very religious. Let me give you a definition. A religion is any organized set of rules or principles that promises the results you desire. I'm going to do that one more time for you. A religion is any organized set of rules or principles that promises the results you desire. Now that brings out a point, doesn't it? Religion is entirely selfish. It is entirely self-righteous in its motivations. That's why James clarifies, and James says, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. He's saying that, you know, you can be saved and be religious, but a lot of people are religious and unsaved, so their religion is impure. It's not doing anything except faking them out. See, there's a boundless difference. Do you know this? There's a boundless difference between the born-again believer and the practitioner of religion. One is an internal change that drives change on the outside. And the other, religion, is the external change with no hope of changing the internal man. None. You need to understand something this morning. I really want you to get a hold of this. Religion is perhaps the most successful scheme Satan has ever devised. There are people who will sit in church their entire lives and go to hell. Nothing can deceive a person into false security like religion. I mean, religion is like, people in religion are like little babies who are just being gently rocked until they're just so secure that they just go to spiritual sleep. People love religion because it gives a person what they want with a kind of a controlled and acceptable cost to self. I can keep a handle on the price I'm going to pay and still make it to heaven. Are you hearing me? See that? Now let me explain something. That's why the world will love the religious person. The world will, and they might even make a religious person a hero in the world. But they will never tolerate a born-again believer. You want to know why? Turn over to Matthew 10. Matthew 10. Look at Matthew 10 and verse 24, if you would, please. Jesus says here, Matthew 10, 24, a disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? Do you know what you just read there? See, when a person is born again, when they're actually saved, they are going to begin following closely after Jesus. Their affections have changed. And Jesus does something extraordinary in that person's life. He makes them become more and more like him. More and more conformed to his image. So the servant is like his master, it says there. And so Jesus says, You know, if they've called me Satan, don't be surprised when they say all kinds of things about you. Now, why would they do that? Do another turn with me. Turn over to John chapter 15. John chapter 15. Look there, if you would, at John 15 and verse 18. Somebody say, have it. Jesus says here, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Now watch. What did you see? This should be like, aha, two kingdoms. Right? Two kingdoms. When Jesus saves you, he saves you what? He saves you out of the world. In other words, at one point, all of us have one thing in common. We were born. We were born into this world, and when we were born into this world, we were born into the kingdom of the world. That's how it is. You were born with original sin. That's how it is. And when you're born again, if you're born again, you're born out of this world and into the kingdom of God. Now, you can practice religion all day long, and the world will be fine with you, but if you're born again, that all begins to change. Why? Because you begin to look more and more like Jesus to the world around you. I ask you to do one more turn in your Bible. Are you ready to go?
Ready.
First Peter, way to the back of your Bible. Way to the back. First Peter chapter 4. First Peter chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh. Who suffered?
Christ
did, yes. So what? Arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has the flesh has ceased from sin. So look, first of all, I want you to see right there what's happening. If you are born again, you're going to be rejected by the world. There's going to be suffering. There will be, and when there's suffering, what does it do? What it does is it helps you to overcome what? Sin. It's the purpose of it. Look at verse 2. So as to live for the rest of the time, whatever time you have, in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. That's what we live for. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles do, that is the world, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. That covers it all, by the way, lawless idolatry. You say, well, you know, I'm not a drunk, I'm not this, I'm not. Look, idolatry. What's your idol? The time is past for following that stuff around. Look at verse 4. With respect to this, they who? The world, are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they do what? Malign you. See it? May I say, holiness is convicting to the world? Holiness is convicting to the world. And without holiness, you will not see the Lord, the Bible says. The world hated holiness in Jesus, they will hate holiness in you. That's as old as time. Why did Cain kill his brother Abel? Bible tells us, because his own deeds were evil and his brother's were righteous. Way back to Genesis chapter 4. Now look, if the world loves you, listen, look, this is going to get tough, you know, if the world loves you, I mean, if you're buddy-buddy with it and it just loves you, it's because you still love the world and John says what? He says the love of the Father is not in you. You're not saved. You're not born again. You are still compromising. You are compromising for gain. That's why. That's your motive. If the world loves you, look, I know some men in this church who still use foul language. Why? Why? Where is the holiness? I know some people who are still looking at nasty stuff on the internet and TV. Why? Where is the holiness? Why do you not fear God? Why are you joining the world? I know some of you are compromising. You are compromising in integrity. You are compromising in your home. You're not leading. Why? Why are you still of the world? Why? Where is the holiness? Where is it? It is written, you shall be holy because I am holy. You shall be. There's no question about that. You shall be if you're born again. You are moving toward holiness. And I'm not quite there yet. Sure, you're not quite there yet, but are you on the road or are you making excuses? When you're born again, you are being conformed to the image of Christ. You're no longer mindlessly going along with the world. You're no longer idolatrous in your pursuits. There are not things that are more important to you. What does it look like to be born again? Would you look at your 3 points with me on your outline? To be born again, first of all, means that you're no longer brought to Jesus kicking and screaming. You want to be with Jesus. To be born again means that I don't just love what Jesus can do any longer. But instead, I love Jesus for who he is. Somebody prayed in our prayer meeting this morning, thank you, God, for who you are. I'm not trying to conform him to my image. I want him to conform me to his. Thirdly, I no longer, if I'm born again, I no longer hate the cost of following Jesus, but I desire to follow him, and gladly I want fellowship with him so much that I follow him right into the suffering. I step right into it because I know that what that does is produces holiness in me and a closeness with him. You know it, I know it. The world loves the power of Jesus to heal, but they hate the cost of following him. Where are you? Let's finish by talking quickly about how to be born again. How can I be born again? Well, first of all, I would make mention of the fact that Jesus says at John 6 that whoever comes to him, he will not cast out. But I think we need to understand what it means to come to him, don't we? That's not on my terms, that's on his. Christ died for our sins. Listen, do I recognize, do I trust, do I believe that my sins are such that it required the sacrifice of Jesus Christ to pay for those sins? My sins required that sacrifice. Do I believe that? Christ died for my sins. Not for that guy that's so horrible or that gal that's this way or that way, but me. For my horrible idolatry, for the hatred in my heart, for my desires. Do I believe that Christ died for me? And if he did, if I believe that, has there been then, because of that, a tremendous change in my affection so that it's not only Christ who was raised, but I've been raised with him to new life. And my desires are for him. Today is the day to repent of desires apart from Jesus, to turn from those desires, and to put your whole trust in him. Father in heaven, God, we ask, please, now that you would do what only you can do. We cannot be born again because we choose to. We can only be crying out to you. But God, we believe with all our hearts that because of your Holy Spirit and because of your word, that there are those who have repented of their sins and put their trust in Christ. God, there is no salvation apart from the cross of Christ. My sin is so vile, so disgusting, so dirty. My heart is so black that it required the blood of Jesus to purify it. So, Father, we give all praise, all glory to you. We ask, God, that there would be those who would clearly see, that you would give eyes to see the gospel of the glory of Christ, the good news that Jesus died for our sins, that he was raised again to new life. Thank you, Father. We know that some are brought kicking and screaming. Some love only what Jesus can do, and some hate the cost. And God, please, please cause us, none of us, to be numbered among those, but instead to be in love with you, to follow you with all we have. And I thank you, God, for this church. I thank you, God, for these people who love you dearly. Father, I thank you for what you are accomplishing in their lives today. Encourage them, please. I ask in Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, so good to be with you guys. And I'm grateful that you're here. Did you have a good Sunday?
Yes.
Praise God. Praise God. Well, go and live for him. Amen.
Amen.
See you soon.